In the last video, we discussed how the uncertainty principle limits our ability to measure multiple properties of quantum objects precisely. This built-in uncertainty allows certain forbidden processes to take place, such as alpha decays. This is strongly related to the fact that quantum mechanics is probabilistic. In the classical world, you can kick a ball into a wall and ask, will the ball go through the wall? The answer is obviously no. The question is seemingly absurd. In the quantum world, however, the answer is maybe. More precisely, depending on the thickness of the wall, there is a probability that your object will go through the wall. This is due to quantum tunneling, which is the topic of today. To understand today's concept a bit better, it is helpful to illustrate the problem with different potentials. In physics, we often consider the kinetic and potential energy. The kinetic energy is like the energy of the object moving. The faster you go, the bigger the energy. We can write the classical energy as 1 over 2 times mv squared, where m is the mass and v is the velocity of the object. Thus, larger objects have more kinetic energy for a given velocity. This also makes sense as it takes more energy to push a car compared to a much lighter bicycle. Potential energy is energy which is stored in an object, and in classical physics, the potential energy is often gravitational, although it doesn't have to be. If we consider the gravitational potential, we can write that the energy of the potential is equal to mgh, where m is the mass, g is the gravitational acceleration, and h is the height which the object can potentially fall. Thus again, a heavier object has more potential energy. We can understand that again by considering the fact that lifting a car takes much more energy compared to lifting a bicycle. Since lifting is symmetric to falling, the car will likewise be more energetic when it's falling than the bicycle. Now we can consider a very simple potential where a ball falls down a hill. The ball starts on the hill of the potential, and initially it's not moving. The energy is therefore purely from its potential energy due to gravity. Thus the initial energy will be E initial equal to mgh, where m is the height of the potential and h is the mass of the ball. If we let the ball fall, it will start moving faster and faster as it rolls down. But remember that energy must be conserved. Thus, as the velocity increases, the ball gets more and more kinetic energy, but at the same time h gets smaller and the potential energy gets smaller too. Thus, the potential energy turns into kinetic energy. At the bottom of the hill, the potential energy will be zero, and all the energy will now be kinetic. Thus, the final energy can be written as the kinetic energy E final equal to 1/2 m times v squared. And from conservation of energy, this must be equal to the initial energy, thus E initial is equal to E final, or mgh is equal to 1/2 mv squared. Thus, in such a potential, the energy is moving between being potential energy and kinetic energy. Now, let's get to tunneling. In classical physics, we have a specific amount of energy, in other words, a number. If we consider a slightly more complicated potential and put in our ball and give the ball some energy, then we know exactly where the ball can be. Its energy can change between being kinetic and potential energy, but its total energy will never change. Thus, if there is a hill in the potential larger than the energy of the particle simply cannot climb it. The classical particle in this example will just be stuck in this little dip in the potential. This changes in quantum physics. Because energy and time is bounded by the uncertainty principle, it is possible to borrow some energy from absolutely nowhere as long as you give back that energy so far that it satisfies the uncertainty principle. Therefore, if we replace our ball with an electron, since the ball is so large that quantum effects become insignificant, then we get a different result. The energy is no longer fixed, so to say. Thus, the energy of the particle can therefore momentarily increase such that there is a small probability for the particle to actually overcome this small hill on our potential. This is the essence of tunneling. Having gotten some intuition for how tunneling works, it's time to look at the time-independent Schrödinger equation, where we write that minus h bar squared divided by 2m times the double derivative with respect to the position of psi plus v psi is equal to the energy psi. As mentioned in the introduction video, this equation has a potential term which must be specified. If you plan to take a real quantum mechanics course at university level, then I will almost guarantee you that the first potential you will be introduced to is the infinite square well potential. But since it's quantum mechanics, there is no guarantee. Anyway, this potential might sound like something fancy, but it's rather simple and in some ways boring. You just have a box with infinite walls and you ask yourself how the wave function will look for different energy levels, E1, E2, etc. Remember that the wave function is related to the probability of where the particle can be. In the case of the infinite square well, the result is rather trivial. The wave function is inside the infinite square well, thus the particle is somewhere in the box. The infinite square well is rather simple, and the resulting wave function is equally simple and not very interesting. A much more interesting and more complicated potential is the finite square well potential. This potential is very similar, but its walls are now finite, and that makes a huge difference. If we again solve the Schrödinger equation and figure out the wave function for this potential, we find something very unexpected. If we look at where the wave function allows the particle to be, we can see that there is a small probability that it is outside the square well. Just by making the walls finite, the wave function has already begun breaking classical physics and begun wandering off into the wall. If we now consider two of these square well potentials next to each other, with some potential barrier with thickness b between the potential, then one finds that the wave function actually allows for the particle to travel through the wall, and the smaller b is, the more likely it is. In other words, we have another concrete example of quantum tunneling. One could consider many other potential and investigate how quantum tunneling applies in such cases, but at the end of the day, the possibility of doing the classically impossible leads to a lot of new phenomena which bring new possibilities and gives some engineers headaches. The double finite well potential very nicely describes the problem which engineers of microprocessors face. Microprocessors, which your computer or phone uses, are made using various of components. But one of the more important components is the transistor, which is like a switch that either allows electrons to pass or not. A transistor, in a very simplified way, is just like the double finite well, and the wall between is called the gate. Depending on how old you are, you might have noticed how microprocessors are using smaller and smaller process nodes, or in other words, they are making smaller transistors. In the late 80s, chips were made using a 1 micrometer process node, and today, modern devices often use chips made from a 7 nanometer process node. The number is not exactly related to how thick the gate of the transistor is, but it highlights the fact that as we have made better and more efficient processes, we have also made the electronics very small. As we saw with the double well potential, if the barrier or gate of the transistor becomes sufficiently small, then the electron will more often than not just go through the gate. But the point of the transistor is to control the flow of electrons. Thus, today we end up with the problem that we can't really make the gate smaller, because then we lose control of the electrons, as they will just ignore our barrier. Therefore, engineers are trying their best to improve transistors in other ways, and it's also why the labeling of the process technology has increasingly little to do with the actual gate size, because we have reached the limit. But it's rather a way to compare technologies and densities of transistors, as one can arrange the transistors in clever ways to fit more in the same space. On a more positive side, while quantum mechanics is a problem in terms of improving our traditional computer chips, it helps paving the way for future quantum computers and other new technology. Nuclear fusion, like what powers the star, also depend on quantum tunneling. So while there are downsides, there are also clear advantages. At the end of the day, we wouldn't be here without quantum tunneling. And on that note, let's end the video. As always, please feel free to comment, like, and subscribe. and stay tuned for more videos.